Grandpa, were you a hero in the war? Grandpa said no. But I served in a company of heroes.
Okay, we want to welcome everyone back to our weekly Band of Brothers study, where you're going to be in Philippians chapter 3 and verse 10 today. Got Jake and Josh and Steve here with me this morning, and I appreciate them being here. So we'll pray, and then we'll jump right into our study of Philippians. So let's pray. Lord, once again, we just we begin our time with you just expressing our thankfulness to you, Father. Lord, you are so good to us. We just look around and we just see your goodness, your blessings, your mercy, your power just displayed in countless ways. And Father, we thank you. We thank you that we can gather together. We thank you that we can that we have Bibles that we can open up and study. We thank you that we have coffee we can drink. We thank you that we have a dry, safe, comfortable place to gather and just fellowship with one another. We thank you for the technology that exists so we can help have our study with our band of brothers that are not gathering with us physically right now, Lord. Father, we thank you that for this time of year, just we thank you for summer. We thank you for green grass and flowers and warm weather and just all of the things in your creation that we enjoy. So, Father, before we do anything else, we just say thank you. Thank you for your love, your mercy, your kindness, your compassion, your forgiveness, your blessings, your goodness. We just say thank you, Lord. And so, Father, we ask for your help as we study your word this morning, God. Lord, today we're going to talk about your power. And Lord, we need your power, Lord, in everything that we do. Lord, we need your power this morning. As we study your word, we need your power, Lord, to open up your scriptures to us, God, to make it real to us, God. So, Father, we ask in faith, Lord, for just an outpouring, Lord, of your spirit, God, that would make your word real to us this morning. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. So we are in Philippians chapter 3, verse 10. And last week we talked about the first thing that Paul says, I want to know Christ. Paul talks about the surpassing greatness, that there is nothing better than knowing Jesus personally, than really and truly knowing who Jesus is. And there is nothing else better than that. And Paul says, that is my number one priority. And then he says, I want to know Christ. Yes, to know the power of his resurrection. You know, Paul, I think about the verses right before this, where Paul talks about his resume. And I think that Paul is kind of saying, or at least in my opinion, Paul is kind of saying, you know, I lived my life under the power of the law. I lived my life under the power of religion. I lived my life trying to access and use this power. And what I have learned since then, I began to learn the lesson on the road to Damascus. And what I have learned since then is that power was powerless for me to break the bondage of sin in my life. That I thought it had power, but what I have discovered since I came to know Jesus is real power. That there really and truly is power over sin. That there really and truly is power over death. Yeah. That there really is truly is power that is available to us to live an overcoming, victorious life. And I thought it was in religion. But what I know now is it is in relationship. I want to know Christ. I think back, I think about what Paul wrote in Romans chapter 7, and that's not in your guys' notes, but I just thought about this. Paul says in Romans 7, beginning in verse 15, I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. And if I don't know about y'all, but this passage of Scripture rings pretty familiar with me, okay? So he says, and if I do what I do not want to do, I agree that the law is good. As it is no longer I myself who do it, but it is sin living in me. I know that nothing good lives in me, that is, in my sinful nature, for I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. Listen to that. Paul is saying, I have the desire to do what is good, but I cannot carry it out. I don't have the power to live the way that I really want to live. You know, I think when we get saved, I don't think anybody really starts out and saying, I hope I really fail as a Christian. I hope I really blow this. I hope I really can't do this. I think we all want to do it. I think we all want to walk the path that God has laid out for us. I think we want to walk in obedience. We want to walk in faith. We want to live victoriously. We want to do that. But we find ourselves like Paul, I think many times, man, I'm trying, but I can't do it. The good things that I want to do, I find myself, I cannot do. Verse 19, for what I do is not the good that I want to do. No, the evil I do not want to do. This I keep on doing. Now, if I do what I do not want to do, it is no longer I who does it, but it is sin living in me that does it. So I find this law at work. This is Romans 7:21. When I want to do good, evil is right there with me. For in my inner being, I delight in God's law, but I see another law at work in the members of my body, waging war against the law of my mind and making me a prisoner of the law of sin at work within my members. What a wretched man I am. Who will rescue me from this body of death? Thanks be to God through Jesus Christ our Lord. I want to do good, but I just don't have the power to do it. I just can't do it in my own strength. I just can't do it. I looked up the definition of power. And it is the ability to act or produce an effect. Another definition is something similar to that. Yeah. The ability to do or act. The capability of doing or accomplishing something. The capability of doing or accomplishing something. So, here's the way my brain works. Okay, here's how I see this. Paul is saying, I want to accomplish something. And that what I'm wanting to accomplish is, I'm wanting to live the way that God wants me to live. I'm wanting to do what God wants me to do. I'm wanting to fulfill the calling. I'm wanting to live a life worthy of the calling. Okay? I'm wanting to live in such a way that whatever happens, I'm going to conduct myself in a way that brings glory to Jesus in a manner worthy of the gospel. That's what I want to do. And I think all of us would say that. I think all of us say, God, we really want to live the way that you want us to live. We really want to do this thing right. But we just can't. We don't have the power to do it. We can't do it. And Paul says, I want to know Christ, okay? But what I need to know also is the power of his resurrection. I've got to have the power to do this. You know, you've got to give me, God, the ability to produce something, the ability to achieve something. You've got to give me that power. I can't do that without you. You know, Jake, you're a builder, constructor, carpenter kind of guy.
There you go.
What's the word? Yeah. You're one of those kind of guys. You probably could do all of the things that you do with maybe just a handsaw and maybe just a regular hammer and maybe just a screwdriver. You might could get some of those things done. But if you've got power so that you can plug in your chop saw and your table saw and your power drills and those kinds of things, you can really accomplish something. I mean, you built a table, you built the benches up there. You can, with power, you can accomplish some things. And so I think that's where Paul is coming from here. He says he understands that he needs the resurrecting power of Jesus to accomplish the will of God in his life. Now, true confession time. For large portions of my life, I have tried to live out my Christian faith without the resurrection power of Jesus. I've tried to do it in my own strength, in my own talents, in my own abilities, in my own timing, in my own wisdom, what I, in my own brain, kind of figured out and said, okay, this is what I need to do. This is how I'm going to do this. And in doing those things, crashed and burned. Right. Failed miserably. And we can't carry out the will of God without accessing the power of God. We've got to have that. And the great thing is, it is available to us. We have access to that power. So let's, Paul says in Romans chapter 6, we were therefore buried with him through baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead through the glory of the Father, we too may live a new life.
Right.
This is how I lived in this power, the power of the law. But now then, because Jesus came and lived and died and was buried and rose again, that power that was involved in all of that, through that now then, I can live a new life. So let's talk a little bit about just the resurrection power. And I want to talk a little bit about just the resurrection in general. The word is anastasis or anastasis, and it literally means to stand up again and keep standing. Jesus is the first person who came out of the grave and stayed out. Yeah. Okay? The way that the early church fathers kind of looked at it is that it was life after death. That's really how they looked at the resurrection. So I went back and I looked at some of the things. If you've never read the book, The Case for Christ, I love that book. I would really recommend that. And in it, he just kind of talks about some things about the resurrection. And so I just kind of put those in the notes. Because Paul says, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection. What is that power? What is that? What really and truly does that mean? So let's talk just a little bit about the resurrection. First of all, it is central to the Christian faith. There is no Christianity without resurrection. We are resurrection people. Okay? That's who we are. Jesus is the only founder of a religion that said, I'm going to die, and then I'm going to rise from the grave, and then actually did that. No other has done that. Jesus said what he was going to do and then did it. It really is a resurrection because Jesus really did die. You know, there is in some circles or whatever, there was really the swoon theory that Jesus didn't really die on the cross. He just swooned. He just fainted. No, Jesus died. He completely died and he was completely resurrected. And it was a physical event. The body was no longer in the tomb. I've been there. And I'll just tell you guys, in case you're wondering, the tomb is empty. Yeah. It's empty. Yeah. I walked in there, and there ain't nobody there, okay? And Jesus physically appeared to the disciples. I mean, this was a physical event. And it was a win. Jesus conquered death. Okay? This was a victorious resurrection. We see every aspect of the Trinity in the resurrection. We see God the Father raising Jesus the Son through the power of the Holy Spirit.